Tip Tut.
Hello everybody and welcome back to Tip Tut and the beginning of a new series. This has been a long time in the making. Intro to Animate CC, formerly known as Flash. I'm going to take you through the basics, what tools there are, how to use them, what the setup is, all the way through to making our own first little animation that utilizes all the stuff that we're going to learn. This first episode, I'm just going to introduce you to everything. And in the second one, we're going to get into the nitty gritty. So let's just dive right in then. Animate CC was formerly known as Flash. It belongs to Adobe. However, before that, I did learn to it belonged to Macromedia. Just a bit of history for you. I've been using it since it was Macromedia Flash, so I've been through lots of changes. It's a vector-based 2D animation software. What that basically means is it's designed for animations, frame by frame, tweening, all those sorts of things. And what vector means is there's two ways that you can render things digitally on a computer classically. There's raster based, which is what things like Photoshop use, where things are rendered in physical pixels, meaning if you scale or squish or skew them, it loses quality if you were to accept those changes. What vector means is the shapes and things that you see on screen are based on mathematical equations. And when you change the shape, it simply changes the equation. For example, radius and circumference of a circle coupled with the color would form one equation. If you change that color, then that equation would change slightly. If you change the scale of that circle, the radius and circumference would change. But what it means is it isn't fixed, meaning when you change those, the mathematical equation changes, not physically hard-coded pixels are changing, which results in loss in quality. That doesn't happen in vector. Things like Illustrator, they're a vector-based program as well. So there are three types of frame that you work with in Animate CC. And when we talk about frames, we're talking about the timeline up here. Essentially, much like Premiere Pro and After Effects and programs like that, you have a timeline where your animation will take place. And if you used After Effects before, you'll understand there are things called keyframes. And what this means is a point in time where a property of an object is going to change. And for that, you would use a keyframe, which looks like this dark filled in circle here. Each of these little rectangles represents a frame. And as you can see, these ones are all empty at the moment, and these have objects on them. Now, if you want to repeat what happened on a previous keyframe, it's just called a frame, which looks blank like this. And what that means is if I just throw in a few frames here, for example, with the F5 key, you can see that if I move between the frames that I have at the moment of this animation, the content changes because they are keyframes. Whereas if I move between the frames that I've just added, the content stays the same because they are simply repeating the previous keyframe. And then finally, you have blank keyframes, which are a point in time where the object changes, but it changes to nothing. And what you can see is this final frame in our animation here is a blank keyframe. There is a change in properties on the stage, but that change is to nothing. And that's basically the three types of frame that you're going to use. So there are also then two types of animation that you can do when you're in Animate CC. There is frame by frame and there is tweening. Now I'll take you through frame by frame first. This is the classical style of animation that they used back in the glory days of Disney since the beginning of time. You draw a succession of images and these are played at speed to give the illusion of movement. If you needed six different frames, then you'd need six different drawings. Not technically, you can do things like working on twos, which we'll get into later. But for the sake of simplicity, you draw six different pictures, each slightly different, and you play them at speed to give the illusion of movement. That's called frame by frame animation. The second type is relatively, well, I'd say is 100% locked to computers, which is tweening, which is where you give the position A of an object, or property A of an object rather, and property B. You choose the amount of time that it has to animate between that, and then the computer generates the rest of the animations for you. So you only have to draw two pictures. Now, the drawback of this is, unless it's incredibly, incredibly simple, the computer will get it wrong. But for something like moving a circle across the screen, tweening works absolutely fine. And the reason it's called tweens or tweening is because it generates the in-between frames, which are known in the industry as tweens or tweening. Finally, then, there are two types of object that you can draw with on the Animate CC stage. There is paint, which is what happens when you grab your paintbrush or your pencil or anything like that, and you just draw directly, what you get is this editable vector path. So you can see I can select it and I can actually make changes post to drawing it. I can move it around and I can delete sections of it. This is sort of your basic bog standard, I call it paint, but you're painting literally directly onto the screen. And the second thing you can do with Animate CC is you can group this paint or your objects or your line work, whatever you want. There's lines as well, which are editable and animatable, you know, things like that. You can take all of those and you can lock them inside a symbol, which means, as you can see, this works a bit more like a layer in After Effects or something like that. The object itself is locked away. You can still adjust things like the scale and things like that on a symbol. But what it does is it actually takes this entire timeline and gives you a separate inner timeline. So now if you double click on that symbol, you'll see that we go back to paint mode, but you can also see that everything else is grayed out slightly and my timeline has changed. That's because I actually have an inner timeline that is local to this symbol. So I could do some animation inside here. Okay, then I could go back to my main stage and that animation would play inside the symbol. But I can then apply additional effects or animations on top of that. So this is useful for things like lip syncing. You can have a symbol with every state of the mouth that you need it to be. And then in your main timeline, you can simply choose the frames of that symbol to represent the mouth noises that are on stage. Same thing with sort of eyes and hands and fingers and things like that. It's also good if you want something looping. So it's like pre-comping if you've worked in After Effects. You basically take an entire timeline and you drop it inside its own little symbol. So that's really all there is that you need to talk about at this stage. Of course, there is so much more, but really for the introduction, that's perfectly fine. So let's show you this then, for example. If I drop a loop in here, and I'm going to play this and you can see our keyframes at work. Now, this is just going to loop continuously. And this is showing the two different types of animation that you can do. Up on layer one on the top of the screen, we have frame by frame animation. And now this document is at 24 frames per second. And what animators usually do to save time is they work on twos. And what that means is generally, unless you need something to have a lot of detail in its animation or if it's moving very quickly, you will have two frames per drawing, meaning you only have to do 12 drawings per second of footage rather than 24. That's because you can see that if I hide this layer, for example, here, this is a perfectly acceptable rate of animation. It's fine. And the human eye is sort of accepted that that's okay. So if you can see here that all I've done is drawn a new picture every two frames. And there's things like squash and stretch, which are animation principles are going on here. This gives the illusion it's moving faster because I've stretched it out. But again, we'll talk about that in future episodes. So what I've done here is literally draw just 8 different images here. It lasts shortly, just short of a second. And those 8 images, when played at speed, give the illusion that this ball is moving across the screen. Okay. Now, the other option that we have here is our tweening. I've drawn 3 stages. I've drawn the ball in its starting position. I've drawn the ball in its ending position. And then I've drawn the ball in a mid stage in between the two. Okay. Now you can turn on a thing called onion skin, which lets you briefly see what is before and after. And if I scrub through here, you can see how this ball moves. Now, all of these ghost images are generated by the computer. I haven't had to draw any of those, which is the benefit of tweening. So if you can play it, for example, you get a much smoother motion because it's technically working now on ones. So there are, you know, twice as many frames as there are on the top one. And if you see the two side by side, you see one is a bit more janky, one's a lot more smooth. It really does depend on what kind of animation style it is that you want. Okay then, so that's the basic principles. I don't expect you to absorb all this at once, but what I do expect is you to be able to work with me next time to create this. Now, yes, it is a stick man animation, and I'm sorry, but I was working in an Animate CC, and I have been for far too many years now. And this harks back to the good old days of Newgrounds and the Zhao Zhao Stickman fights, and I just couldn't help myself. It also is good to show that you don't need a super complicated animation for something to look good. a stick man jumping in the air with flames coming out of his feet looks just fine. And it does actually explain all of the principles that we just talked about. You can see that on some layers, like the effects layers there, which is all the flames coming out of his feet, there are blank keyframes because, you know, drawings aren't needed for those frames. You can see I've separated out into three layers. One of them is the red, one of them is the yellow, and one of them is like the details. And then you can see, for example, that on the head of this stick man here, this is an object, a symbol. Inside that symbol is just a single frame of his head. What that means is I don't have to redraw his head every time. And also his head doesn't change shape or size. It remains constant throughout, which is good for maintaining consistency within your animation. You can see that on the body frames, I have paint here. That's all these little dots over it, which I can manipulate if I need to. However, I don't. Again, working on frame by frame animation. You can also see that I have some guide layers in place that if I make them visible, they basically give me the head of my character and his waistline so that I don't accidentally squash him, make him, when he's over here, I haven't accidentally drawn him shorter. For example, you can see that he remains roughly the same size throughout. And you can actually just hide those if you don't need them. And you can see that I've used motion tweening for his shadow. And in fact, I've used a combination of motion tweening and frame by frame to show that the two can coincide. So his shadow moves with motion tween there, frame by frame for this section because it was easier to match up, and then back for the motion tween for that fast dispatch on the end there. So next time then, we're going to look into creating this, and it'll probably take us a couple of episodes because I'm going to go nice and slow. I may do a different animation. I'm probably not going to copy this because what's the point? We don't do copying here at TipTap. We do creating. So I hope you'll join me next time for that. I'm really excited to get this series going. Please, please, please do make sure, I know it's such a YouTube thing to say, but if you do want more, make sure you like this video. It really does help. Also means that non-TipTutters will actually be able to find this video a bit more easily, and hopefully that'll help the channel to grow. Finally then, do make sure that you head over to the Discord community that we set up called the TipTut Zone. This will be the perfect place if you're starting out for Animate CC to chat with other people that are also starting this journey at the same time as you, and hopefully you can converse and share ideas and just grow together as artists. And I'd really, really like to see you there. So thanks very much for watching, everybody. Let's dive right in next time. I'll see you then.
Remember to subscribe for more tips, tricks, and tutorials. Thanks for watching.